This is the story of NLM City Hopper Flight 431. On the 6th of October 1981, a Fokker F28 regional jet was to fly from Rotterdam to Hamburg with a stopover in Eindhoven. By the way, YouTube, please don't demonetize me for the plane's name. That's literally what it's called. Speaking of what the plane was called, this particular F28 was called Eindhoven after the city that it was about to fly to. On that day, the plane had 17 occupants for the short flight from Eindhoven to Rotterdam. The weather on the 6th of October wasn't too good. A depression over Ireland was really messing up the weather systems over the Netherlands. A weather system moved over the country over the course of the day. Cold and warm air mixed together, creating some nasty weather that day. It wasn't the best of day for flying, but nothing seemed out of the ordinary just yet. By 3:20 p.m. GMT, the crew had their first weather briefing. They were told of a thunderstorm that was located southeast of Rotterdam. It was something that they had to keep their eye on as they climbed out of the airport. The weather report said that the weather system would pass over the airport at about 4 p.m. GMT, with winds ranging from 15 knots to 25 knots. Nothing to worry about. At 4:04 p.m., the plane took off. Right after takeoff, the plane banked to the south over the city. As they did, they checked the weather. They noticed some very intense activity on the weather radar and asked for a change of course to avoid the worst of the weather. The plane sped up to 230 knots as it started to enter the outskirts of the storm. They were aiming for a break in the clouds. They hoped that the small opening in the weather would keep them away from the worst of it. As the plane waded further and further into the weather system, the plane started to be buffeted by strong winds from either side. As Flight 431 passed the river, the Holland Diep, it had climbed to 3,000 feet, and by that point, the turbulence had gotten much worse. The plane was experiencing G-forces of up to 6.8 Gs. The small plane held out for as long as it could. On one of these encounters, winds pushed the right wing of the plane up, and then the right wing was pushed down by the turbulence. With so much force being put on the wing, the right-hand wing broke off. An intact plane had entered the storm cell, and a broken one emerged from it. The plane came down near the town of Moerdijk. No one on board survived. Saying that Flight 431 had flown into some turbulence is an understatement. What they experienced was something much more violent. Something that wasn't well understood at that time. They had flown into a mesocyclone, or in other words, a tornado. In fact, after the crash, a picture of a tornado touching down was captured by a resident. Before we can understand how a passenger jet flew headfirst into a tornado, we need to understand how a tornado could form in such a way that no one could detect it. A mesocyclone is basically a giant vortex of rotating air, and it all starts with wind shear. On that day, there were two fronts, a cold front and a warm front. This caused winds to blow in two different directions. At the intersection point of these winds, the air starts spinning. The boundary gets reshaped into this roll of wind. Now you have a horizontal tube of rotating air. The air is now picked up by an updraft. Thus, the horizontal tube of rotating air becomes more or less vertical. With time, the updraft begins to rotate with the rotating column of vertical air, and voila, you have a mesocyclone. This at lower levels is manifested as a tornado. This isn't exactly small. A mesocyclone can be anywhere from 2 to 6 miles wide. That's not nothing. How could an airport weather report miss something so huge? Well, for one, back in 1981, the process of mesocyclone formation wasn't that well understood. If you don't understand something, you can't combat or mitigate it. Apparently, at that time, an airplane encountered something like this once every 3 to 5 years in Europe. Honestly, back in the day, they were fighting a losing battle. They just did not have the tech needed to detect mesocyclones. Even today, mesocyclones aren't detected directly. Weather services use Doppler radar to search for telltale rotational signatures, which then match certain criteria to then ascertain the severity of the mesocyclone. Back in 1981, the controllers at Schiphol did not have access to Doppler radar. They stood no chance of detecting this tornado. Here's a quote from the report. Consequently, it cannot be said that in this case, that the whirlwind could have been recognized or predicted. End quote. Recognition and prediction was outside of what was technologically possible for the controllers at Schiphol at that time. But even if they could detect and track the mesocyclone, there was a problem in the system which would have prevented the pilots from getting that crucial information in time. Back in 1981, it would take 20 minutes for weather information to go from the meteorologist's office to the pilots. First, a meteorologist would look at a radar screen. Then they would draw the weather conditions that they saw onto a map. Then that map would be sent out to airports in the area. The problem with this is that the weather info that the pilots do get is always 20 minutes old. That's a lot of time, especially when you consider the fact that mesocyclones only last for about 10 minutes. So how do you protect against something that you can't see or detect? Today we have Doppler radar that can detect mesocyclones. But what did they do back in 1981? The report said that they wouldn't have the tech to detect and track these tornadoes for a few more years. So their solution was to use the technology that they already had to its fullest potential. Then they realized that they needed to disseminate weather data faster to pilots. 20 minutes was just too long. In addition to that, they realized that there was a need for local meteorological services that could constantly monitor storms. After all, prevention is better than cure. The best way to avoid getting caught up in a mesocyclone is to stay away from all thunderstorms. So they suggested that planes stay at least 10 to 20 nautical miles away from storms, as they are often accompanied by other phenomena that is not always visible to the human eye. The crash of NLM City Hopper Flight 431 laid the foundations of a lot of technology that we take granted for today, from almost instantaneous weather updates to a more comprehensive weather monitoring system to separation requirements. A lot of it was in the recommendations of this crash. What's the worst turbulence that you've ever been in? Let me know in the comments below. Today's episode was much shorter than usual because the final report is only 8 pages long. There isn't a whole lot to go on. Also, the report was in Dutch and I had to use Google Translate for this video. So if this video does contain any errors, something definitely got lost in translation. Feel free to correct me in the comments below. Also, if you feel like you want to watch another video, might I suggest last week's Air India Express 1344 video? You can find a link to that video on your screen right now. Thank you for watching this episode of Mini Air Crash Investigation. If you like the videos that I make, do consider liking and subscribing. It will really help the channel grow. I will catch you guys next time. Stay safe.